Well, good noon to everybody. Welcome. Thanks for coming. I'd just like to remind everybody that reviews for all the sessions are on Skedge.com. So after the session, you know, please jump on there and give us your feedback. We'd love to hear it. You know, one of the things that you know, we could all use a little bit more of is some help. And I'd like to introduce Henning Jacobs, head of developer productivity for Zalando.
Great. So who is running Kubernetes in production? Who here? OK, it's not everyone, apparently. And who's just here to see others fail? Come on, some. I mean, it should be more. OK, today we will talk about socks. Because I learned on SREcon that if you sell socks online, you should really build your own Kubernetes. And guess what? Zalando, as a fashion company, if my clicker works, we sell socks online. So, of course, we build a lot of Kubernetes tooling. And we're not so small anymore. So we have 5.4 billion revenue last year. So we don't only sell socks, but all fashion and clothes. And we have quite some scale, so 380 AWS accounts. I don't know the accurate number right now, but it's this kind of ballpark, 118 clusters, and a lot of developers using Kubernetes. So around about 900 to 1,000 developers using Kubernetes. And yes, Kubernetes is complex. We have a lot of components. So this is our open source GitHub repo with our cluster configuration. And you see, I counted, it's 47 plus components. Of course, not all core components of Kubernetes, but stuff you badly need to provide Kubernetes as a service. So with this complexity and scale, it should be clear that incidents are common. And I brought you today 8 incidents. So I have a lot of slides, and I will rush through them. But let's start with the first one. And I always start with the impact, because that's how the story goes, right? The murder stories always start with a murder, and then you try to have the trail of clues. So first one is actually our checkout. So you can guess in our checkout, you need to select our payment method, for example, invoice, credit card, et cetera. And there is some risk evaluation behind that. And this was failing at this time. So what happens here is that the risky payment methods were no longer available for the customer. And it can guess this is badly means potentially losing money or not a good customer experience. So I showed you some graphs. Everything is from postmortem, so all the graphs are not perfect. That's what I got from postmortems. So first of all, we see this payment method, the offering rate dropping. And we see in the cluster, which runs this component, also ingress errors. So the green bar here is requests. And a successful request, the red bar is 500 errors, and the yellow one is 400 errors. So as you can guess, this doesn't really look so good with this graph. The client side saw some 502 errors. And actually, what they saw is not just any 502 errors, but 502 bad gateways with some server header AWS ELB 2.0. So we're running at AWS, and we can already guess what this means. So the AWS ELB doesn't have really any healthy nodes in the backend. So this is a graph from CloudWatch. So you can see the black line is the number of healthy hosts of the ELB. And this drops to zero, which means, OK, this will not really work anymore. And here you also see the 200 rate. What you can also see here is actually the request rate doesn't go up or skyrocket. So it's not like something where you say, like, OK, it's overloaded, there is a denial of service or anything. It's just something is broken, and barely healthy host goes to zero. So how our ingress is set up, and this is all open source. Our ALB controller is open source. Skipper is open source. It's our HTTP proxy. So the TLS is terminated by ALB, and then HTTP goes to our HTTP router Skipper, and then it goes to the internal Kubernetes network. What was happening here is when we look at Skipper memory usage, you see the memory limit here as like 500 megabytes. And you see this really reaching nearly the limit. And you see some missing data points. So these small gaps means like, OK, then nothing was running. And then, of course, during the incident, someone bumped the memory limit. OK, this doesn't look good. So what was really happening is memory out of memory for our Skipper HTTP router in ingress. So OK. Out of memory, this is, I guess, pretty common for people running on Kubernetes. But what is really happening here, which is the interesting part here, is that first of all, contributing factors shared ingress. So the whole cluster has one ingress setup, one ALB, and one like set of Skipper nodes. And what was happening here is actually not the app itself had a problem, but the unrelated application, which is in this case Solr, has nothing to do with this, what I showed you earlier with the payment method, where they had a high number of in-flight requests because they did some upgrade and they have like latency of minutes. So there was a high number of in-flight requests, and this led to a high number of memory usage of Skipper because it's in written in Go, and you have like a Go routine per HTTP request in this case, 2 kilobytes of memory, which is not a lot, but this barely summed up to exceed the memory limit, and the memory limit was fixed. So there is now a fix for that in the open source Skipper, which is a LIFO queue, if you're interested. Okay, incident two. Also, starting with customer impact, this is our PDP, product detail page, which is obviously really important for customers to buy something. And you see 500 errors. Doesn't look good. We also see 400 errors, 404 specifically, on our IAM infrastructure. So we use OAuth service-to-service communication, and our IAM infrastructure returns 404 errors. We also see in the cluster where our IAM infrastructure is running is a spike in pods. So normally maybe 400 pods in the whole cluster, and then it goes up to 3,000 pods. Right? This doesn't really look good. So just a reminder, so we have our ingress setup, ALV, Skipper, and then going to the app. And what Skipper does, same as the ingress controller, it barely needs to watch or poll the API server and then update its routes for ingress. What was happening, the API server was actually out of memory. So the API server was down, Skipper could not update routes, and therefore Skipper, in this case, of course, a bug in hindsight, barely had no correct routes, and that's why we saw 404. What was causing this high number of pods is actually YAML. So we saw in the previous talk, YAML, YAML, YAML. In this case, it's some time ago. So this is the YAML. I don't know if anybody spots this. Like the indentation is wrong, but that's my fault. But badly, this is cron job in the early days, and this is correct YAML. So badly, we had a cron job which was not validating and had some history limit, and it was at the wrong place. So badly, the cron job went rogue, and the pod number exploded in the cluster. So learnings, of course, we need to fix our ingress that it stays healthy when the API server is down. But also, we added a resource quota for the number of pods. So we tested at that time, 1,500 pods is safe to run in the cluster, and the API server is not being killed. We recently dropped resource quota. I was made aware by my team, but that's another topic. Incident three. So again, the same graph, right? Ingress errors, not looking good. Everything is on fire. So 500 errors, 400 errors, and no successful request. And this was actually caused by Chordian S, out of memory kill. So I don't have so much data because also monitoring is affected if DNS is down. So some OOM killer messages, and this is from Prometheus. You see the restart count on Chordian S going skyrocketing, and this is not looking good. So what we did, of course, to stop the bleeding, we bumped the memory. So it was 200 megabytes, and bumped first to 2 gigabytes. This was also not enough. Then to 4 gigabytes, and then it was fixed. So OK, you might ask, what is causing this? So first of all, it started with a spike in HTTP request. So you can see this is like HTTP request. It spikes. It's not so high, the spike, but anyway. At the same time, you barely see the DNS request QPS spiking in Chordian S. And then also, of course, the Chordian S memory going up and barely exceeding the memory limit. So, OK, like again, out of memory, like a classical theme. And what was actually here the contributing factors? So first of all, we had in this app, we had HTTP retry. And retries are good, right? But in this case, it was making everything worse. We had no DNS caching at that time. And there is this N.5 problem. So who is aware of N.5 problem? OK, so we only have experts in the room. But this is barely making everything worse. So barely, if you think you make one DNS request, look closely, you might make 10 because of N.5 and then IP version 4 and IP version 6. We also had a short lifetime of HTTP connections. That's why there was so many DNS requests. And Core DNS had a fixed memory limit. And also, contributing to this whole incident, monitoring is also not really working if your whole cluster DNS is not working, right? So we also lacked some visibility. OK, the postmortem is also written up in the link below. Incident 4. again, like some Grafana chart, and you see this is just a node number per cluster, and you see there is a big gap, so the cluster is down, okay, huge fun, and you see this command, etcd control delete, and this looks maybe fine, maybe not, but what is rm minus r a b doing on the command line? That's probably deleting a and b, right? That's what you're used to on the Linux command line if you run rm. But what the etcd control actually does, it's using the first argument as a key and the second one as a range end. So it's not deleting A and B, it range deletes everything in between, right? So it's not really intuitive. So, and it's still the case. So whoever designed the CLI tool, I don't want to blame you, but this is not intuitive. So please make sure that your CLI. But there's this very nice talk by Kate, which I can recommend. It's also on YouTube by SREcon. So if you need senior engineers to do like manual work on your production environment, then you're doing something wrong, right? So junior engineers and like barely human error is not really an option, right? So learning for us is not to fire this engineer who did this etcd control delete run, but actually to make sure that this is not really relying on any manual operations and that we have proper backups and snapshots. Okay, number five, API latency spikes. So this is the API server of Kubernetes, and you see this is a y-axis is going to 1 second, so it's actually not looking so crazy, but I don't have better graphs in this case for this postmodern, but really it just tells you something is not so good anymore because normally it's like just a milliseconds. And I think this is just a simple get pods, so, or maybe even a get one pod. So it shouldn't take 1 second. So what was happening here is actually, okay, API server has some problems, and this is, might not be a big problem yet, but what we can see actually from the postmortem here, Kubernetes worker and master nodes sporadically fail to connect to etcd, causing timeouts in the API server and disconnects in the pod network. So at that time, we use Flannel with etcd backend, so badly Flannel and API server could not really connect to etcd, and this is, of course, not good if your overlay network cannot really access its storage and API server neither. So, first of all, okay, we see the symptom. We, of course, want to stop the bleeding. So what do we do? This sometimes happens. This was actually happening over weeks. So, of course, we stop the bleeding, write a shell script, system control, restart etcd member. If it doesn't return the timeout, this is good enough, right, to stop the bleeding. So then we actually looked deeper. So this went on for weeks. And then actually we got the answer from AWS that this is kind of related to T2 instance types. And this is, I think, a fun quote because it barely says, we don't recommend T2, or so we don't explicitly recommend against running production services on T2. But like, OK, which way now? So it barely, OK. Badly, be careful, right? Normally, it's never the AWS infrastructure, and that's also what I told my tell my engineers. So this is my screensaver, by the way. But T2 instances might be special. Ask your TUM of choice, maybe, for details. And what is more fun in this learning, actually, and in this post-mortem exercise, is that actually Kubernetes components are not really cloud native. So if you look at the cloud native definition, I mean, this is like the real definition. I think it's just from last year. But it contains declarative, dynamic, resilient, and scalable. So resiliency was not really built in here. So API server was not really reconnecting. The Flannel was not really reconnecting, because the cause here was that only one packet was dropped, one reset packet from A to B. So we figured this out. TCP dump, and so this was on the AWS layer. So one packet drop badly was causing this huge problems between API server and etcd and also Flannel and etcd. So badly resilience is not really given in the core Kubernetes component. Okay, incident 6. Okay, again, some shard for ingresses, ingress errors. So this is from CloudWatch this time. 500 errors go up. And we see another chart. This is a number of nodes chart again. We see missing data points again, cluster down, not very good. So in this case, this was a trigger. So this was a so our cluster configuration is on GitHub, and we have different channels, which I explain in a second. And barely this merge of the pull request was triggering this what was happening there. But first of all, of course, human error is not really something we want to deal with, and this can never be the root cause. So let's look at how we do cluster updates. Cluster updates are done, in our case, via Git flow. So we do a feature branch for example, cluster upgrade, PR, then this PR is tested, and then it moves through these different branches. This is all done by this cluster lifecycle manager, which is also on GitHub. So it basically uses Git repo for storing all this Kubernetes in, cluster information and configs, and then uses kubectl apply and CloudFormation to update the clusters. These different channels basically look like this. So we all the changes move through these channels. So we start with dev, which is development playground clusters. Then we have a special alpha channel, which is actually very important for us because our own platform infrastructure cluster runs in this alpha channel. And then we move to beta, and then finally to stable, which is basically the rest of the company. OK, and we do tests on PR. So this was a merge in this cluster config. And there are conformance tests running, Zalando tests, so pretty good. And how they were running was we create a cluster, a new cluster. We run end-to-end tests. This is conformance test plus custom Zalando test. And then we delete the cluster again. This looks pretty good. But it's not good enough, right? So we all know database upgrades and similar migration scripts. So what we actually needed to do, and this is what we fixed after this incident, is actually we need to test the upgrade path. So we need to actually create a cluster, run it with the old version, then update it via this change, and then run end-to-end tests, and then delete the cluster. Because the actual PR, which was merged, was totally fine by itself on a new cluster, but it was not fine if you run badly the previous version and do an in-place upgrade. So this we fixed now, so we really test the upgrade path. So end-to-end tests, we felt comfortable with what we had before, but we actually forgot that we didn't really test the upgrade path. We only tested this with a new cluster. So we bootstrap a new cluster, apply a new configuration, and then run end-to-end test. This is also the end-to-end test all on GitHub. And there is also a README by Mikkel, I believe, how to run this on your own clusters. And you also find our custom tests. So if you badly want to have more confidence with your own clusters, then you can run this official conformance test plus custom test. Incident 7. So this is also a fun one. This is from the chat. So way to go, kubelet. That's maybe the quote to keep in mind. Way to go, kubelet, because it ate barely 9 gigabytes of RAM. So this is Kubernetes 1.12. And of course, if kubelet eats 9 gigabytes of RAM or more, then all containers on the node are probably down because not the cgroups OM killer will hit you, but the node and the system OM killer will hit you hard. And here, just a memory graph, right? So this kubelet should not really take 10 gigabytes of memory. So we opened the issue in 1.12.5, memory leak in kubelet. So we observed failing nodes. So this was pretty regularly, and we could always see this memory curve. And there was a very simple patch, deleting one line. What is it? Set reflector matrix provider. There's also the Kubernetes issue. So later we found out this was actually not happening to everyone. This was only happening to people running Hypercube because you have a strange side effect when you import something in this Go package and then this reflector matrix are enabled. Anyway, there's a discussion and the issue linked here. So basically, this was one of the few upstream bigger problems we saw. And this was also not happening to everyone upstream with Kubernetes 1.12.5, but only if you ran Hypercube, which is barely everything bundled into one container. OK, then incident 8. So first of all, let's look at the impact again. So this one is what probably many users might see sometimes when they start a pod or something, that they have this mount volume failures, and this one for secrets. So how this works in our case? We use this OAuth service-to-service communication. We actually inject secrets into clusters. So people don't have to do anything with credentials. They just read the secret, and they barely get an OAuth token. And these secrets were not working anymore. So any new Kubernetes deployments were failing. Now, looking at this application, which was actually injecting the secrets, this is a Java app, but Java doesn't really, it's not a contributing factor in this case, but this is a Java app, and you see this queue size basically processing this credentials going up from 7,000. I mean, it was normally is kind of like 0 and then to 58k. So badly, this Java app on Kubernetes could not really process these credentials fast enough and inject secrets anymore. Why is that? Because CPU is throttling. So this is like resource requests and limits for CPU. The green bar is usage, the blue bar is limits, and the red bar is basically the right y-axis, which is the percentage CPU throttled. And as you can see, the CPU limit was at 3, and then you see this is actually pretty high, so we reduce the CPU limit because the usage is pretty low, and then basically the CPU throttling exploded. And it exploded much more than you would expect because it's like barely cannot really do anything anymore because it's so much throttled. So why would anybody reduce this limit? So it doesn't look so wrong, right? Because there is this huge space between the green usage bar and the blue limit. And barely we wanted to reduce slack. Slack is barely the amount of usage and requests, the diff between these two. And also we had actually in the whole clusters more deployment. So the process could not process credentials fast enough. Slack, just briefly, so this is barely you block resources with resource requests, and the usage might be lower, so the difference is what I call slack. And you don't want to have too much slack because you pay for slack, which barely is resources you don't use. So, of course, also in this case, not really was not really the fault of the engineer. And what we figured out is actually that the CPU throttling is much more aggressive than you would might think. And at the end, after some discussion also with Google engineers last KubeCon Copenhagen, last year's KubeCon Copenhagen, we barely disabled CPU CFS quota in all our clusters. So barely our CPU limits have no effect on throttling anymore. And this was so far the right decision because barely we don't really have to care about CPU throttling anymore. And as long as you barely treat requests with care, this works fine because you move your workloads into this completely fair scheduling of the kernel. And barely this helped us a lot and also helped our users because they don't need to think, okay, do what happens with this throttling. I heard yesterday someone is actually spending some time with teaching like users how to detect CPU throttling and how to change it and so on. So basically, it helped us a lot and also increased automatically our performance and decreased latency. So a lot of ways to crash your cluster. These are only 8 incidents. So let's look what else happened. So we had a lot of Docker problems at the beginning. Now I think we see Docker problems again. I don't know why, but Docker daemon freezing is not a nice experience. And I guess a lot of you have seen similar things. DNS is definitely a huge topic. You saw this core DNS incident. Actually, we now solved this with daemon set, so core DNS plus DNS mask for caching per node. And this also leads to some high latency. So if your user says, oh, sometimes DNS queries take 5 seconds, please believe your user. It's true, even if you don't see it yourself all the time. So like, then look into the DNS topic. Disabling CPU throttling, I already mentioned it, to fix latency issues. Client Go has some problems. I don't know if it's now fixed, but my screen saver again. So Client Go has some problems. So what we did is actually adding a proxy in front of it, which is not the best way to handle the situation, but OK. We have some 502 sometimes when we have race conditions during cluster updates. Graceful pod shutdown is also a huge topic. I think not so many people talk about. Then there are incompatible Kubernetes changes, maybe not on purpose. So for example, there's this one small bug fix which made badly config maps and secrets read-only, which is totally fine. But if you have 200 plus teams, you can be pretty sure that some of these teams badly exploit this previous bug and write something to the volume of config map and secrets. And this was what happened in our case. CoreOS Container Linux, stable, at least the name was saying stable, won't boot. Kubernetes EBS volume handling was really bad. I think now it's kind of fine on AWS. And Docker is always a topic. Just some examples. Race conditions. So this is Sleep 120 for the flannel setup. I'm not sure if it's still there, but this is always nice to see if you see anywhere Sleep. I think yesterday also in one talk I saw some Sleep command. So this is always a good hint that something is not right. Timeouts to API server, I already mentioned it with client Go. So actually, we added the etcd proxy in front of it as a sidecar. Also not really nice, but helped us to stop the bleeding. So you will say, OK, these Zalando guys, they sell socks online and run their own Kubernetes on AWS. So what about all the managed Kubernetes? So managed Kubernetes, will it save us? So first of all, EKS, 99.9 service level agreement. This looks really good. GKE also have some, I don't know what the current, I think they don't have SLAs anymore, but the Google guys can correct me, but basically some uptime percentage. So it looks quite good, right? So you would say, OK, we have a managed service. But I would say, if we look at the 8 incidents, it will not really save us. Because first of all, if you look at the EKS SLA, first, this is only for the API server. So how many incidents do we have with the API server? OK, maybe there's one with out of memory, which is some time ago. But most of the stuff is all the other components. So like only SLA for API server will not really save you from incidents. Also, if you look at some blog posts about EKS, you will badly find this. This is very good, so check it out. Production-proofing EKS and a long list of things to take care of, which also makes you wonder if this is out-of-the-box production-ready. Of course, it's not, because if you look at the DNS setup, it starts with a single pod. So badly, the same problems we had with our core DNS setup, which was already kind of a little bit elaborate, you would have in the same situation again. So we barely make sure that you scale your DNS and your cluster in the right way and test it and load test it. Also on GKE, I mean, this is famous. This is in every second presentation, I think. This is this health check script, which barely just checks if a Docker daemon is still responding. If not, we do a pkill. So OK, apparently not everybody saw it yet, but I think it's in every second presentation. I saw it so many times now. But anyway, so yeah, so you still have Docker, you still have containers, you still have CPU throttling and so on. So all these other stuff you still have with managed services. Of course, some things you don't have to handle. For example, the etcd stuff in master control plane is badly managed. But in the end, really welcome to Cloud Native. And like most of the postmortems were not really written by me. So someone who contributed is also here in the first row. So his Twitter profile already says it. Like he's writing Kubernetes postmortems at Zalando Tech. You'll find him in the first row. So if you want to know more, I'm not the expert. I'm just like living up and living from others' failures. And there is more. So I, of course, don't want to talk about other people's failures and other orgs. So there is this nice domain, which Joe Beda thankfully handed to me, which is just a simple README. So my biggest success as an open source project is a simple README, which is like this Kubernetes failure stories with 2,900 stars in GitHub. So, and we need more failure talks. So we had the Istio talk before. I haven't heard any Istio failure story yet. And that makes me wonder. So please, if you run Istio, come to me, contribute some failure story. I'm pretty sure there must be something. Otherwise, either nobody runs it in production, or I don't know. So yeah, just contribute. So I like tweeted beforehand, if I see here this 1,500 people, that's the capacity of this room. Imagine all these 1,500 people, or let's say only every third person contributes to failure stories, how much better we would be in the Kubernetes land with production readiness and so on. So please, like, only has to be every third person here in the room, so it's good enough. OK, so many things I showed here are open source. So our whole cluster configuration is on GitHub. This is not really something you can use out of the box, but you can look at it and maybe learn from it. We have our AOB ingress controller open source, which is an alternative to the CoreOS one. Skipper is there. External DNS, we are still looking for some more maintainers. And we also run Postgres on Kubernetes, so there's more for failure stories in the future. And that's already it.